keep getting toilet infections. My breast brings out milk. I'm not pregnant. How can I make my tighter? I keep having miscarriages. I have blocked tubes. How can I calculate my safe period? I have been taking postinor. Will it affect my fertility? How can I have a male child? How can I have twins? Let's talk about stuff. Is it possible to cure fibroids without surgery? Can abortions cause infertility? I have low sperm count. Please help me. In this video today, we'll address these issues, and luckily I have an expert, a US-based Nigerian-born medical doctor, and he's largely known for his interesting and engaging lectures on maternal health and fertility. Hello, Dr. Chudi.
Yeah, thank you so much, my brother, for this opportunity.
Can repeated abortions in the past cause infertility in the future?
We're talking about induced abortion. So a lady that intentionally went and had abortion. Mm-hmm. When abortion is done clean, by a professional, and it's done properly, there is no direct relationship with subsequent ability to become pregnant. However, if it was poorly done, septic abortion, that means you had infections subsequent to that abortion, or D and C, they excessively removed the cover of your womb, and it led to what we call Asherman syndrome. The walls of your womb, the nature of the cover of your womb can change. So anything that changes it can lead to inability to become pregnant. Probably they damage your tubes or they damage the cervix. But on its own, abortion directly cannot stop you from becoming pregnant subsequently.
Okay. Is it possible to cure fibroids without surgery?
Some persons meet me, they say, I just bought one thing, is fibroid melter, shrinker, dissolver.
At some stage in your life, you're going to develop fibroid. Some people wouldn't even know they have fibroid. It's dependent on three factors: the size, the symptoms, and the location. If your fibroid is relatively small, it's not giving you any symptom, it's not inside your womb, then we're gonna let it be. But the problem with fibroid is the probability of growing big, and also the location. If you have a symptomatic fibroid, obviously the best way to go about it is to go for surgical removal. Now there are a couple of newer trends of attending to fibroid that might not require you to go for surgery. Couple of things you can do to reduce your risk. So cut by your alcohol, maintain your diet, Mediterranean diet. So more of fruits, vegetables, fish, and a little of water. Then balance your hormones. So some people go out there, they abuse postinor, they abuse oral contraceptives, and there are some other things in the environment that might contain estrogen. So avoid blood pressure, get enough sun, your vitamin D. When you do all this, you are reducing your natural risk of developing fibroid. The best way to handle fibroid is medically. Drink this, none of those things are evidence-based. Based on the size, based on the location and the symptoms. Like some women will notice changes in their cycle. It's very heavy, it's very painful, painful sex, it's coming out in big clots. Then you go for diagnosis. We need to classify the type of fibroid you have.
Exactly.
Is it intramural? Is it submucosal? Is it subserosal? Then we can begin the management. So some people can have expectant management. We won't really do much.
Can I buy Clomid on my own and take it? You know, the fertility drugs women use, and you know, it increases the chances of having twins and so on. Can I walk into a pharmacy, buy Clomid on my own and take?
Clomid is a drug we use in inducing ovulation, or if you have a couple of gynecological problems. So it's a fertility drug. You should never walk into any pharmaceutical shop, you know, buy Clomid and you begin to use. Clomid can help and harm you. You only use Clomid if your provider saw a need for you to use Clomid and monitor you appropriately. So when you increase the level of all these hormones in your body, you're not just predisposing yourself to having problems, you're also going to predispose yourself to developing cancer in the future. No matter how you're tempted to use Clomid, your friend can come and tell you, oh, I used it and I had stay off Clomid if it's not prescribed by your provider.
Let's talk about staph. You know, you hear about staph a lot. Men complain about staph infection.
People will take themselves to the lab without anybody directing them, and anytime you go to the lab, my sister, my brother, they will find something. Staph, moderate, heavy, and it's not just staph, they will combine it with Candida albicans. Leave your staph alone. The organism, it's just like any bacteria organism that is just on pretty much surface of everybody doing their own thing. Yes. They are there, they're not disturbing you. So yes, if you find stuff, you will find stuff. So the concept of overwhelming evidence of stuff,
yes,
the reason why you haven't started your family is because of stuff. Now, some people might be predisposed to having real staphylococcal infection.
Yes, yeah.
If their immune system is messed up, so you can pick up a lot of things. But by default, if you search staph around me, you're going to find it. Staph and candida are not, read my lips, related to your inability to start your family, both for the males and for the females.
Yes.
When you begin to go to the labs without going to the doctors, you are taking needless in-season antibiotics. If you have a need for antibiotics in the future, you will have what we call resistance. You've cleaned the good guys, giving room to the bad guys. Save your money. If you have infertility, see a fertility specialist.
How can I have twins?
Two ways you can principally have twins.
Yes.
Naturally and with the help of assisted reproductive tech. So the only reliable way is to go for assisted reproductive technique. Top on the list is IVF, in vitro fertilization. There are some characteristics which can give you an added advantage to have twins.
Yes.
Your origin. If you happen to come from a family of twinning, your mom had twins or whatever, you have increased tendency. Location, Nigeria happens to be the capital of twinning in the whole world. So there's a particular area in Nigeria we call Iwara in Yoruba land. Virtually every family there have twins. We discovered there's a particular type of yam and cassava they eat. Yam and cassava have high level of estrogen. The older you are, the more the probability and likelihood you're going to have twins. The fact that when you're getting older, especially when you get to 35, you now have fewer quality eggs.
Yes.
So women that are older can easily have twins and multiple pregnancy compared to younger women. Now, there are also some fertility drugs like this Clomid I mentioned. If we use Clomid effectively with guidance, with monitoring, we can combine it with IUI and you might be lucky and you can have multiple pregnancy.
If you are not born in a certain place, then find a way to marry to a certain
Correct. They can even relocate to the area in Yoruba and
eat their yam. How can I have a male child? People tend to prefer male child, and a woman will feel as if she's not had children yet if she doesn't have a male child. A man will feel that he's not man enough. Is it possible for one to choose?
Yes, you can. You can go for gender selection. Now, we also have to talk about reliable, evidence-based method of having gender selection and unreliable, whatever you can take, whatever happens, 50-50 methods. The mechanism that leads to selection of the male child is actually from the guy.
Yes.
So males are the people that will determine if you're going to have a baby boy or a baby girl. Now, based on the nature of the egg and the sperm, how fast and the egg and stuff, there are some natural ways of targeting when you make love in regards to ovulation, to get a baby boy, to get a baby girl. But guess what? It's not reliable. The only reliable way of selecting your boys is to go for a special type of IVF. We'll carefully select the Y chromosome and we carefully make sure that that's what you're going to have. Through the process of pre-implantation genetic selection. So it's possible. It's expensive.
If you're finding this video interesting, do well to hit the like button and I would deeply appreciate it. I keep getting toilet infections. What is the way out? There are some ladies who believe that if they start having itching, rashes, discharge, vaginal odors, then it's because of a particular dirty toilet they used. And then it can be recurrent.
Mm. So many infections can mimic each other. That vaginal discharge, that itching, that pain during sex, that pain during menstruation, can be sexually transmitted infections, can be what we call UTI, urinary tract infections. Now, when we talk about the toilet infection itself, that's actually a layman's way of, in medical field, there is nothing like toilet infection. The way you clean is very, very important. Because there are some organisms that live in the anal region. You do not want to communicate between the anus and the vagina. So in some women, if they are cleaning from the anal region back into the vagina, they will introduce all those
bacteria. They clean from back forward instead of cleaning backwards.
So if your immune system is messed up, you're definitely going to be prone to picking up a couple of things. Some women put a lot of nonsense into their vagina. They tightening, perfuming this. Anytime you disrupt the natural way God made the vagina, you are increasing the possibility of infection to come in. It's important you are treated properly. So if we tell you to take your antibiotics for 1 week, take it for 1 week. Don't stop.
I have been taking postinor and other emergency contraceptives. Will it affect
my fertility in the future?
Guess what, guys? Thankfully, yes. It cannot directly. Now, your postinor is not your average friend. You're not supposed to be taking it for every sexual encounter. You only take it if you forgot to use the other one. Yeah. Now, thankfully, the washout time when you use your postinor is easily metabolized in the body. So the short answer is no. So the reason why you don't have a baby today is not because of the postinor you took when you were growing up.
How can I calculate my safe period and ovulation period?
What you need to know as a woman is your cycle, interval between your two bleeding days in the 2 months. So the normal range, the normal cycle is from 21 days to 35 days. So long as you're fluctuating between these two ranges, you are good. Now, the opportunity and the method of calculating your safe period is relative to your age. So if you are younger than 35 and you have a regular predictive cycle, you know that you're 28 days, you know you bleed for 5 days, then we can begin to have conversation about your safe period. So your safe period is when you guys can make love and you won't have the opportunity of becoming pregnant. Your unsafe period is what we call the fertility window. Okay. How do we calculate the fertility window? We begin to look at the lifestyle of the sperm and the egg. The egg can survive just for 24 hours and it will die off. But the sperm is a rugged cell. The sperm can survive up to 7 days and in average 5 days. So the fertility window is when you have the highest potential of becoming pregnant. And it's a 5 days gap before your ovulation and a day after. So that period of 7 days, it's when you are not safe. If you have regular predictive cycle, any other time outside that window, you can make love. But guess what? Depend on reliable contraceptive. You can become pregnant at any time in your cycle, including during bleeding. Though you cannot ovulate during bleeding, but if you make love during your bleeding, in some women that have a short cycle, they can become pregnant.
I have blocked tubes. What can I do?
For you to become pregnant, you only need one tube. Thankfully, God gave women two tubes. So if anything happens to this side completely and this side is healthy and open, you can become pregnant.
Great.
The management of tubal blockage is based on the extent. So if your tube is mildly blocked, when we are investigating you, we send you for HSG, hysterosalpingogram. It's one of the fertility tests we will go for. When you are going for that hysterosalpingogram, if you have mild blockage, by default, it's going to push that mild blockage and you can improve your fertility. When you went for that test, HSG, they flushed the minor.
They flushed it. Correct. Yes.
Now, some women can have moderate blockage and they might go for what we call hydrotubation, which is the popular flushing. But here's the problem. If it's confirmed that you have completely blocked tubes, your best method is to go for option of circumventing the tubes. So you go for IVF. The fact your tubes are blocked doesn't mean it's end of the world. We can still forget about the tubes, get your ovary, get your eggs from your ovaries, and still get you pregnant.
I keep having miscarriages. Help me.
Majority of women will even have miscarriages without even knowing they had miscarriages. All those delayed period that later came out in big clots.
Period.
Some of them will have miscarriages, but you didn't know. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, the biggest factor is what we call chromosomal problems. So the best way to manage this is to carefully have a holistic approach.
Yes.
You follow up with your medical provider. You modify your lifestyle. You take a couple of medications. Some of you might require to go for surgery to have extensive investigation. You need to look at the hormones.
Yes.
So we can also do some genetic study to see what we can do, then you go for genetic counseling. Now, some women might also need to be treated for infection, or if your progesterone level is not good, or if you have weak cervix, cervical incompetence, make sure that you have a high-risk pregnancy specialist to plan your pregnancy so that we will carefully monitor you
monitor.
And give it the best we can.
I have low sperm count.
Sperm count is one of the parameters we check in assessment of the male fertility index. We check the motility. Is it moving forward? Because we want the sperm to move forward from the vagina to the cervix to the womb, then it begins to go to the tubes. Very good looking sperm. So we look at morphology, motility, and count. Your lifestyle can affect your sperm. Some men drink like fish. Some men do not exercise.
Yeah.
They do not eat properly. There are some men that can't see their penis because their belly is so big. So they use drinking and eating all those nonsense and sign of opulence. You can get back your fertility, your sperm quality by the time you modify your lifestyle. So you exercise. exercise, you eat good food, you focus more on fruits and vegetables, you avoid your alcohol, you drink your water, you avoid stress. Now, some men can have low sperm count based on block pathway in the transmission of the sperm to the penis.
Yes,
that's a good aspect of low sperm count because we can go in and collect the sperm. But if the problem you're having low sperm count is from production, from the higher centers, then that's the one that might give us a little problem. So by and by, you need to see a urologist.
How can I make my tighter?
Train the vagina, just like you train your muscles. There are muscles in the vagina. So there are exercises you will engage in. It's called Kegel exercise or pelvic floor exercise that will strengthen the muscles in the vagina. Now, will your vagina be the same when you've had a baby or as you're growing up? No, it never becomes the same. You will lose the elasticity. Some of them will look like it's shrinking.
Yeah.
You do not put any nonsense inside your vagina in regards to tightening it.
Yes.
So just make sure you engage in careful Kegel exercise.
My breast brings out milk, yet I'm not pregnant.
The reason why you have that galactorrhea is because of another hormone we call prolactin.
Yeah.
When your prolactin level is very high and you're not pregnant and you're not breastfeeding, it will lead to expression of breast milk. Thankfully, there are specific medications we can give you to take care of that. If we can bring your prolactin level down, then we can correct the galactorrhea, then you can ovulate and have your baby.
Can a pregnant lady menstruate? Is it possible to bleed and see your menses even while you are pregnant?
Once you are pregnant, no more bleeding. There is nothing like I'm seeing my period, I'm having my menses, it happened to my sister, it happened to my grand auntie. It's called bleeding in pregnancy.
Yes.
When you are bleeding in pregnancy, by default, we take it as an emergency. Now, that bleeding can be due to what we call implantation bleeding, which can happen to some women, which is relatively, we are not worried about it. When the union of the egg and the sperm, the embryo is implanting.
Implanting,
you can bleed. Implantation bleeding is something that will result within about 24 max 48 hours. Now, some women might have concomitant infections or inflammation or bleeding disorder, or maybe you are having threatened miscarriage. That baby is about to be aborted.
To come out.
One of the signs in threatened abortion is bleeding and low back pain and all those stuff. So anytime you wipe, you spot, anytime you see blood, run to the hospital. Yeah. Now, once you are pregnant and you are bleeding, you must observe three S's. No sex, no spots, no stress. No activity, no running up and down. Even that you exercise, we encourage you to do. Suspend
that.
Any bleeding in pregnancy, please seek help immediately.
Let's talk about exercise and sex during pregnancy.
Focus on uncomplicated pregnancy. If your pregnancy is going good, you don't have any problems, you didn't have previous recurrent miscarriages, you're not bleeding, nothing, you are given 100% license to make love. If you want to make love from morning to night and eating it like your vegetables, that's okay. So long as you're not placed on the list of no-do. There are people that are placed on no-do list. Actually, love making during pregnancy creates a lot of bonding. When you make love, you release what we call endorphins. Endorphins are few good hormones. So you have to still exercise because we don't want you to add unnecessary body weight that
body
can complicate your pregnancy.
True.
But your exercise in pregnancy must be moderate.
Moderate.
You go to the gym and you're jumping up and down like a monkey. Don't be a gym rat. Just moderately do stuff you're used to. You can even begin to make love up till you get to labor. So thank you for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you very much, Dr. Chidi. I deeply appreciate. If you find this video very helpful, do well to hit the like button and stay subscribed to this YouTube channel. Check the description section below for all the relevant links and access to Dr. Chidi. Take charge of your health and happiness, and I'll see you in the next video.